Yeah, so welcome to this rather unique experiment that we're trying here at the library tonight. In celebration of National Short Story Month, we have three award-winning writers with us to talk about short fiction and writing and answer your questions and whatnot. First, let me introduce everyone, and then each writer will do a short little reading. And then I have a bunch of questions to ask, and then we'll just turn it over to the floor and any questions you guys have to ask. Hopefully, we can try to stump them. Okay, so we'll start first by introducing Laura Vandenberg, right here. My bios on all of you are probably sort of outdated because you guys keep winning stuff, but Laura was raised in Florida and earned her MFA at Emerson College. Her first collection of stories, What the World Will Look Like When All the Water Leaves Us, was a Barnes & Noble Discover Great New Writers selection, was longlisted for the Story Prize and shortlisted for the Frank O'Connor International Award. Her second collection of stories, The Isle of Youth, right here, and available at our library. Was nominated for the Story Prize and appeared on over a dozen Best of 2013 lists, including those from NPR, the Huffington Post, Cosmopolitan, the Boston Globe, and Flavorwire. Laura lives in Boston. Okay, in the middle here, we have Jessica Hollander, who for the next 12 hours lives in Northport, Alabama. She is moving tomorrow. She's a graduate of the University of Alabama's MFA program and teaches English, composition, and creative writing at the university until tomorrow. Then she'll be teaching somewhere else. Her stories have appeared in Pank, Web Conjunctions, NAP, West Branch, and others. And her debut short story collection, In These Times, The Home is a Tired Place, which my copy is like an old early publisher's copy. Maybe, Jessica, do you have a copy of your book actually there? The real copy looks much better than the copy they gave me.
Ben, hold yours up. I can't see it.
Oh. It's just, you know, spiral down. Anyway. It won the 2013 Katherine Ann Porter Prize for Short Fiction. And lastly, right over here, we have Ethan Rutherford. Ethan was born in Seattle and now lives in the Midwest for another couple months. Then he'll be moving to New England. His stories have appeared in Plowshares, One Story, American Short Fiction, New York Tyrant, Five Chapters, The Best American Short Stories, and plenty of other places. His work has received special mention in the 2009, 10, and 13 editions of the Pushcart Prize and received awards from the University of Minnesota. He has taught creative writing at a slew of places, and his collection, The Peripatetic Coffin, was nominated for the inaugural John Lennon Prize and won the 2014 Minnesota Book Award. I just updated the bio on the fly there, Ethan. And was named one of Publishers Weekly's best summer books of 2013 and was a Barnes & Noble Discover Great New Writers selection. So, this is who we have speaking with us tonight. And yes, hopefully you can all do a short reading for us and then we'll get to some questions.
Okay.
Do you want to start, Laura, since I introduced you first?
Sure. Hi everyone, I'm so glad to be here with you virtually. I'm going to read just the opening section of the first story in my collection, The Isle of Youth, and this story is called I Looked for You, I Called Your Name. The first thing that went wrong was the emergency landing. My husband and I were both reading In Flight magazine and enjoying the complimentary wine in first class. I'd never flown first class before, but it was our honeymoon, and we thought that was what we were supposed to do, drink in the daytime, luxuriate in our good fortune. When the plane lurched, an oxygen mask fell from the ceiling, and a passenger in the back screamed. We didn't know it then, but the pilot was already steering the plane toward an empty brown field, preparing for our descent. The landing itself was terrifying. A hard, screeching wallop that knocked us around in our seats. wine spilled into our laps, bags overturned and people's possessions spread into the aisle. My husband elbowed me right in the nose and I tasted blood in my mouth. When we finally stopped, the flight attendants, all of them leggy and red-lipped, applauded as though the emergency landing had been performed for our amusement. I unbuckled my seatbelt and cupped my nose, stunned silent by the pain. The seatbelt sign is still on, my husband said, resting a hand on my back. I leaned forward, away from his touch. These were the kinds of moments that had been recently giving me pause. We're new at this, I kept telling myself, but there was no denying that I was often confounded by his priorities. I sat up and touched my nose. It felt swollen. I looked down at the pool of red in my lap and dipped my pinky finger into the wine. We thought we had overcome the worst, having endured the flight from Newark to Houston, the 10-hour trip to Buenos Aires and the connection to Patagonia, but all I could think about was how wrong we'd been. My husband continued staring at the illuminated seatbelt sign, my entire face hummed with pain. It doesn't matter anymore, I said to him, licking the wine off my fingertip. We're on the ground now. I'll stop there.
Thanks, Laura. Jessica, you
sure.
Want to go next?
Okay. I'm going to read the beginning of my story from the collection, In These Times of Home is Tired Place. The story is called This Kind of Happiness, and I see it as kind of my collection in terms of theme and that kind of thing. So here I go. In the middle of a mandatory meeting about proposal distribution, the girlfriend excused herself, took the stairs to the second floor bathroom where space belonged to her, all these cubes she could enter, doors she could latch. Here she could carefully read the directions and administer the test. She could sit on the toilet watching the white sticks cloudy window without the boyfriend asking, what's that? What's wrong? Are you? And home, the boyfriend was everywhere. He occupied the bathroom with her, flossed while she showered, shaved while she peed, because, he once told her, the windowless linoleum floored room with the ceiling fan cranking and the curling water streaks and the clumps of hair in the corners was the loneliest room in the apartment. The girlfriend went into a bathroom stall and took the pregnancy test. She waited. The bathroom door opened and a pair of red Mary Janes paused in front of her stall. Do you mind if I get on the phone? The shoes asked. I guess not, said the girlfriend. The shoes walked away and then shortly, I meant to wake you. I want you to be a thick-tongued idiot when I tell you. If I'm driving and I see you in the street, I'll smash you into a fire hydrant. The girl in the red shoes laughed. Two pink lines made their way to the stick surface. The girlfriend stuffed the test into the trash receptacle. When the girlfriend exited the stall, the red-shoed girl stood stooped with her elbows in one of the sinks looking in the mirror. He's a puddle I keep slipping into, she told the girlfriend. The girlfriend nodded. There were a lot of puddles. Big ones were easy to avoid, but small ones seemed a moderate challenge. People walked right into them. Already, the girlfriend's senses seemed heightened to damage. She avoided coffee in the morning, tuna at lunch. Hot tubs could injure the embryo, strenuous exercise and soft cheese too. She recalled these things she'd read. She moved slowly around the cold apartment, crossed the icy drive with her puppy mittened hands in front of her like she wanted the world to pause. Wait, hold it, she inched forward. On their food-stained love seat, the girlfriend sat down with the boyfriend. He pressed his lips together. She knew he had his suspicions. They'd been reckless with protection, a test tube experiment, maybe. They were, after all, in their late 20s with no reason to move further down the path of standard expectations. But the path was there, in the increased telephone pleadings from parents, in the pictures of wedding cake smiles and babies in beanies their coworkers posted in the office. The girlfriend and boyfriend hovered before the paved path shaded by thick trunk trees, lined with trim grass and manicured mansions, where miniature houses played mailboxes and animals played lawn ornaments and people played happiness. She told the boyfriend, don't be angry or nervous or excited. She suspected all such reactions were momentary and dishonest, learned responses to what had happened to millions before. There will soon be a reason, she said, to go down the toy aisle at the supermarket. The boyfriend nodded. That is not an inconvenient aisle. They shifted so slightly their ankles touched. The boyfriend asked, will you marry me? Should we buy a house? The girlfriend shook her head. She did not like being referred to as the girlfriend. She knew the boyfriend found this amusing, but was also hurt by it. And it was for both reasons he called her the girlfriend all the time. Meet my girlfriend. My girlfriend likes boiled chicken. My girlfriend's feet are always cold. He forgot her real name. But fiance would be worse, wife the worst. They had crossed over the threshold and could run down the path if they wanted. The girlfriend felt like hobbling around the entrance for a while.
Okay. great. I feel like I probably should have chosen to read from the beginning of the story, but I'm going to read like the final page of one of the stories, so spoiler alert. This is the very ending of a story called The Saint Anna, and I'm just going to tell you a little bit about the story to kind of get you where you need to be. So it's 1916. The Saint Anna has been locked in ice for 2 years, and the crew of the ship has had a really horrible time sort of in the ice. Half the crew of the ship has actually left the ship. And the story is about the people who decided to stay aboard this ship as the ice is kind of crushing it and sort of coming. And it's kind of become clear to them that they're never going to get out of the ice. They stayed aboard because they kept thinking the ice was going to break, and it didn't. They go a little stir crazy, and they blame their captain for bringing them there. And so they end up killing their captain, among other terrible things that they do to each other. So this is immediately sort of following that. So, after this, there are no days. The St. Anna groans in the ice for who knows how long. The feeling is that time itself has become unmoored. At night, I dream of a large whale of some kind, swimming in great dives below the ice. In the water, I move through slanted columns of light. Above me is the keel of the St. Anna, like a boulder wedged in a snowdrift. Below is an infinite blue darkness. I have reached an understanding with myself. Whatever a person is, whatever he possesses that makes him real, after my time on this ship, I am the absence of that. I am not specific. I am the opposite of specific. Everything streams through. Our whole timbers are giving. 1 or 2 weeks later, Vlad dies in his sleep. Yevgeny checks for a pulse, finds none, and proclaims him lucky. We tie Vlad to a sledge and lower him to the ice. We are delicate and sincere. We trudge half a mile south, stop, and lay a pair of skis and a cross on his chest. It is only on our way back to the St. Anna that we allow ourselves to comment on the fact that around our ship the floes have pressed themselves into jagged ridges, and our masts are pointing well aft. The sun, having witnessed the burial, shines and reflects brilliantly off the encrusted rime on our stays. Our ship, the fixed point in a frozen gyre, collapsing now under the incredible pressure of the ice, we see that the St. Anna will be splintered and swollen. We see what will happen a month before it does. And what of us? If we had courage at all, we would wrap ourselves in blankets and meet the weather with fateful and furrowed expressions. Instead, we methodically empty the hold of all remaining food and fuel. We empty the ship and lay everything out on the ice. It takes us 2 weeks to prepare for our journey. The mapping equipment, we leave. The personal effects, we leave. The rifles, tents, biscuits, dried fruit, sleep sacks, and everything else, we pack into a single sledge that can be pulled across the ice by the six of us, hitching in turns. The St. Anna now stands almost perpendicular to the ice, as if she herself were some great frozen beast breaking the surface of the ocean, lurching up from the deep. Her masts have cracked, her portals are frozen shut. We tell ourselves that when stretched so thin, men will shame kindness and become unforgiving, that survival itself is a form of grace. We tell ourselves that just beyond that ridge, just south, will be an open channel, an island, that we will be rescued, that lives begin and end every day, and that we, having passed through more than most, are simply about to embark on another.
Great.
That seems like a passage from Parenthood, actually.
I was just going to say, all those excerpts just totally tie into these questions. This is great synergy here. So I was looking through all of your collections last night, and it really struck me how location plays a major role in most of your stories, right? And almost sometimes location is a character in and of itself. So I was kind of curious, how important is finding the right location, right setting when you're writing a story? And anyone, just feel free to jump in.
I think for me, it's enormously important. I think of landscape as being a narrative force sort of in itself, right? Like it's this thing that can apply pressure to the characters, I think, in useful and interesting ways. And I think, like, for me, one thing that often comes up too is not only that question of landscape, like, is this the right setting, but also how best to approach that landscape. So there's a title, a story in the Isle of Youth that's called Antarctica. And as the title suggests, it is set in Antarctica. And I've been trying to write a story set in Antarctica for probably like 7 or 8 years. I have this weird Antarctica obsession. But for a really long time, I was trying to write from the perspective of a research scientist. And so I always tell my students that they're only limited by what they can convincingly imagine. And every time, I probably wrote 4 or 5 different versions of the story in Antarctica set from the perspective of a research scientist. They were all horrible. I had, like, you know, my friends read them, and they were just sort of like, yeah, no, this won't work, won't ever work, just, like, move on to the next thing. They were kind of irredeemably bad. And one thing that, you know, I came to realize over time is that when I thought about, like, the landscape of Antarctica, which is very foreign to me, the landscape of science, which is also very foreign to me, that's not a part of my own background at all, I was really coming up against the limits of what I could convincingly imagine. And so the version of this story that I ended up, that ended up working for me, in that version, the narrator is a visitor to Antarctica, and she's very much a stranger in a strange land, and I found that when that burden of expertise was lifted and I only had to register the world in a vivid way for the reader, all of a sudden, like, I could write the story. So I think that that's always a big question for me. I mean, I'm very place-oriented, I think, just both in life and on the page, and so I often get these attachments to landscapes, and then the question becomes how best to approach that landscape in a story.
Yeah, I agree. I read Antarctica. It's a terrific story. And I think the only thing that I would sort of jump on to sort of what Laura said is that for me, I mean, setting really is character. One of the things that I feel like you try to do as a writer, and this happens in short stories a lot as well, is there's a lot of pressure to get some sort of, like, antagonist or some sort of, or a lot of friction into your story very quickly. And it makes me uncomfortable sometimes sort of bringing in a human antagonist to essentially get your character out of his or her comfort zone, because that's where the interesting stuff happens, essentially, when your character is out of his or her comfort zone. And for me, the way out of that, the way out of having to sort of bring a villain into the story that I could sort of never really do, or something that would challenge your character, was thinking about setting this character. And so it's essentially the way that I approach a lot of my short stories is it's sort of a counterpoint characterization where you take somebody who's completely unsuited for a particular landscape, and that's the landscape they go to, and then you go, all right, let's see how this is going to turn out for you. And that's how a lot of my stories have come to be. The other thing for me is that, you know, writing, for me, it's you use your imagination, and when you sit down to write, you're writing fiction, you can go anywhere you want to go. And so most of the locations that I go to, that I write about, are the places that I just sort of daydream about, and this is kind of my way there, if that makes sense.
I also see location as functioning as another strategy that you can make use of for symbolism or for tension or for tone. But unlike Ethan, I usually write about places that I've lived in previously. So I have a hard time writing about places that I'm currently living in. But then once I leave, I get really interested in how I can manipulate them. I guess I feel like I can't when I'm living there because they're too, multi-dimensional or something. But once I leave, I can manipulate them. They almost take on a particular aura to me or something that I can manipulate into fiction.
Jumping on that, Jessica, actually, I feel like a lot of writers, that's absolutely right. I have a good friend who's from Queens, New York, and he now lives in the Twin Cities. In Minnesota, and all he writes about is Queens. That's all he writes about. And you go, well, why don't you just move back to Queens? And he goes, are you crazy? Then I wouldn't be able to write about it anymore. There's some sort of imaginative sort of distance that you need to imagine a place without that place kind of getting in the way of your work.
Yeah, similar kind of thing. I'm from Florida. I lived in Florida from birth until I was about 22, and it was only in this second collection, The Isle of Youth, that I wrote stories that were set in Florida. So, I mean, I went through my whole MFA, for quite a while and was sort of like really adamant about not writing from Florida. And it was sort of, it took that time away and took kind of circling back to Florida as a place for me to sort of see it as literary material. So it's interesting, right, how that perspective changes our artistic relationship to a place.
Mm-hmm. So building off of that, Ethan, you've written actually an essay sort of on this idea, but I want to sort of talk about how major life changes or events for our audience. Ethan's wife gave birth to a baby just a few days ago. Kids, marriage, all this sort of thing, do these things affect your writing positively, negatively? Does it make things harder to write about, easier to write about, et cetera, et cetera?
I will never say that getting married and having children affected my writing negatively. You will never get me to say that. I really love to hear sort of what Jessica and Laura have to say about this. So I'll just sort of quickly say that what happened for me, my story is the death count in this book, in the book, the first collection of short stories, I tried to tally up how many people died and met sort of terrible ends aboard ships that exploded and all that stuff. And I just couldn't do it. I couldn't count how many people died. And I was really interested as a writer in violence until I had my first kid, which was 2 years ago. And suddenly, overnight, I no longer enjoy imagining violence. There's something about it that is just, I'm not interested in it anymore. And that's definitely a change that's happened to me as a writer, having a kid sort of come into your life. And I'm much more interested in other things. And I like the development. I mean, I don't want to sort of be stuck on ships for my entire life. But that's something that really did happen. I used to use violence as a way to get tension into a story, and I just can't bring myself to do it anymore. And it was a surprise to me.
Well, for me, pretty much, I feel like major life events give me almost all my writing material because I have such anxiety about them. Yes, I got married because I love my husband and wanted to get married, but also it was really easy, an easy thing to do because we're told, our whole lives by our culture and family and friends that we should want to get married and we should want to have kids. So, I love these things that are in my life, but I'm constantly kind of questioning myself and my motivations. So my fiction is a way for me to kind of explore the anxieties and the questions I have and are surrounding these life events, I guess.
Yeah, I don't, it's funny. I mean, I think it's such an interesting question, right? That relationship between the life and the art. I think I'm honestly sort of still trying to parse what that relationship looks like for me. I mean, I think in a basic way, I'm not a parent, but I am married, and my husband's also a writer. And I mean, I think in some ways that anything just that increases your range of emotion, like for like whether it be positive emotion or negative emotion, is good for, is like probably ultimately good for our art. Anything that just increases that spectrum of feeling. But I think for me that, you know, I grew up in a really interesting, weird, sort of dysfunctional household. I mean, my parents are wonderful people individually, but and they're now divorced, but you know, they have a, you know, a difficult marriage. And a, you know, just sort of a big eccentric Florida family. Anyone knows anything about Florida, that's, you know, even without the family stuff, that's eccentric enough. So in some ways I feel like when I write about sort of marriage, like the couple that was in the story that I read from, I feel like I'm really sort of going back to that kind of old place more than I'm sort of looking to the present state of my life. But I do think one thing that's sort of eternally interesting to me is that how fundamentally unknowable we are. And that you can know someone for your whole life. Like I talk to my mom, you know, several times a week. I talk to my dad, you know, at least several times a week. But yet there's still aspects of their person that are unknowable to me. I've known my husband now for a decade, but it's like there's no way to be absolutely certain what a person is thinking or feeling in a given moment. As much as we might think we have that certainty, it's sort of impossible to have that uncertainty. So that gap that can exist, even in really intimate relationships, to me is it sort of freaks me out, quite frankly, when I think about it in life, but it's I think it's a really interesting place to go back to on the page.
Yeah, you know, I was thinking both of your guys' stories, you both do really a great job at dramatizing doubt.
Totally, yeah.
It's a really hard thing to do. It's something I really admire about both of your work. And I think that it's something that kind of gets short shrift. Like, you don't, when you sit down to write, or at least for me, I don't go, okay, what do I have doubts about? That's going to be sort of a good subject. But I think it's really fertile, and even in your guys' stories particularly, I think it's excellent.
Yeah, thank you. That was always sort of my thing, you know, when I was in an MFA, and that question of like, what is this character's problem? What is this story about? I mean, it took me a long time to sort of understand that something I was really kind of passionately interested in writing about was doubt and ambiguity and sort of a character who's kind of filled with questions.
Okay, so branching off of this, I felt like that was the end of the conversation there, so I was just going to move on. Is that okay?
Doubtful.
we don't know.
Well, I mean, the excerpt that you read, Ethan, it's a story based on, it's a fictionalized, semi-fictionalized version of an actual event. I mean, Santa Ana was a very real ship, and that was a very real situation. So I'm curious how all of you, how truth plays into all of your writing. You know, do facts ever kind of get in the way of fiction, et cetera?
I'll answer this really quickly, and then I'm really excited to hear what you guys have to say. I do a lot of research for my stories, and it sounds like Laura, I know that you do too. But there's a line where there's such a thing as, there's generative research where you sort of are researching to sort of get your story going. And then I feel like the key is to know when to stop researching and let your imagination sort of take over. So for the story that I read, the St. Anna, I read the book called In the Land of White Death, which is the story of this horrible Arctic expedition that went poorly. The story was written by one of the guys who left the ship, and nobody knows what happened to the people who stayed on the ship. And that suddenly became the thing that I was interested in telling a story about. It's like, what are these holes where you don't know sort of what the facts are. So for me, there's sort of that quick line, you can over-research, and facts can get in the way, because you start to sort of, you read more about a specific story that happened in history, and you go, well, that story's been solved, I now know how that story ends, and you cease to kind of be interested in it. I've destroyed more awesome story ideas that way, and just by not knowing when to stop, than anything else. So I feel like that's the sort of thing that you sort of have to keep in mind when you're messing with historical stuff, is like, just get yourself off of the tarmac and trust yourself to tell the story. And then you go back and then you do some sort of adjusting with the historical truth. But you you don't let fact shape the story that you're trying to tell. It's kind of fact is in there to buoy and sort of give it like some authenticating detail. But you're trying to get the emotions of, at least for me, you know, the emotions of what sort of the characters are feeling.
Yeah, I think, I mean, my research tends to be place-oriented. So to use the Antarctica story as an example, my favorite way to research place is to go to a bookstore and get all their travel guides or all their books, maybe not all, some of their books. About a particular place, and so I remember going to a bookstore and being like, everything you have on Antarctica, because there was not that much, I want it. And then the booksellers were really excited for me, because they're like, oh, you must be going to Antarctica, how amazing! And I'm like, only in my own mind. So my approach, when researching place is to, yeah, take a lonely planet, something like that, and just read it cover to cover. And I find that is, as Ethan said, I love the word, you know, generative research, and also the idea of just kind of getting off the tarmac. I find that approach often gives me the kind of basic information that I need to know, the basic parameters that I need to know. But also in these travel guides, you often find these sort of weird, delicious details that sort of feed the imagination. But I'm conscious of that too. I mean, I think in some ways what you're often trying to do is just to acquire a small bit of knowledge and then sort of stretch it out over the course of a story, that it's not necessarily important to become like a complete expert in this place or this era or this situation, but just to, you know, I think the lens is more about how much information or what kind of information do I need to write convincing fiction.
Yeah. I don't do a ton of research, I guess, for my writing, but I can say that in terms of being curious about what you're writing, about, like, not knowing too much, I think it's important. Like, you have to have that element of sort of curiosity to kind of follow through with a piece, whether it's place or historical event or character or... But it's interesting because in both of your guys' work, and especially in Ethan's, I felt like so much of the stories that did revolve around historical events, they felt really surreal. They felt almost like they took place in another realm or something. So I don't know if you have anything to say about that. Like, if you're manipulating in a way to create a kind of alternate space than what would be in the history books or something.
Yeah, I mean, it's my favorite thing. Laura goes and reads travel guides, and I go into libraries and read children's books, because they give you just enough information about, like, a submarine without sort of, but they don't over explain things. It allows you to sort of out of mentioning, you know, the question that she had was, she said the historical stories are surreal, and that's on purpose. I mean, I'm not trying to write historical fiction. I mean, using a historical fact to sort of get into my own kind of weird world. And so I'm happy with that hybrid, and that's what I'm trying to do.
Are you, can you hear us, Jessica?
I can. Am I still frozen for you? Yeah.
You're still frozen, but you're smiling, so that's good.
To go back to about that sense of curiosity, I think that's really important too. And I wonder sometimes, I mean, obviously, at times we might be explicit researching, you know, like a specific situation or era or place or whatever. But I think that there's, for me at least, I feel like there's a lot of accidental research that happens too, just sort of being in the world. And sometimes, like, you find that thing that you've been looking for, but you didn't know that you were looking for it. Like, I was in Key West last summer, and I really, I remember getting dragged to this storytelling, a storytelling open mic, essentially. And I was like, oh my God, I do not want to go to this. This is going to be so horrible. It was amazing. Largely because we were in Key West, and, you know, you got to hear this like boat captain who lost his boat named the Bad Rhonda in a hurricane. So Key West open mic storytelling hour, yes. But like I heard this amazing story that ended up sort of inspiring like a central scene in a novel that I was working on at the time. So I think that like that sense of curiosity, just as we move through the world, that sort of accidental research that can happen is important too.
I'm going to ask one more question and then turn it over because we've been going for about 40 minutes so far. So all three of your collections are threaded together with reoccurring themes, right? So be it childhood or siblings or isolation or parenthood, these themes, of course, not all three of your books have all those themes, but those themes sort of are present in some of your books. So I'm sort of curious, when you write, how conscious are you of these threads? Do they sort of come about as you're putting a collection together? After you've written a bunch of stories, do you then say, oh, wow, I see this now when I'm sort of putting this together for a book?
For me, it definitely happened after the fact. I wasn't overly conscious. And you know, I wrote the stories in the collection over maybe 6-7 years. One of them reaches back even 7 years. And so I had a lot of stories to sift through when I went to put together a collection. And that was when I started seeing some of these themes. And then, you know, it was really fun to think about ordering and, you know, how to kind of draw out, like, where to start, where to end, and kind of how to draw out some of those themes as I then, after the fact, kind of organized. It was almost like working in a different art form, in a way, once I started kind of compiling them.
I mean, both my collections have a lot of thematic linkage in the Isle of Youth. I mean, there's relationship, there's all the stories are narrated by women, but probably the most explicit linkages is that all the stories are sort of slightly inspired by a kind of noir sensibility, and they all involve crime in one way or another, or mystery. And in some ways, the manifestations are more literal, like there's a story about two sisters who run a private eye outfit together. There's a story about a group of teenage bank robbers called the Gorillas that are on a crime spree in the Midwest. And then sometimes it's sort of a little bit more theoretical, like the stream itself, the doubt that Denise had mentioned earlier. So this kind of like, I mean, it was a funny thing for me because in some ways the origins of it, I mean, it was almost like an accidental book because I was working on this novel that I had mentioned previously, but I'd never written a novel before. And as it turns out, they take a really long time. And so this thing would happen where, you know, I'd written the first draft in 2008 and I was going along, and then I would just get sick of it. And I would sort of think, I just cannot look at this document anymore. And I would take a break and I'd write a couple stories. And I'd take a break and I'd write a couple stories. And this cycle sort of repeated itself over the course of 3 or 4 years. And then at a certain point, I realized that I had a collection. However, I would say after maybe I'd written the first 3 or 4 stories, I mean, certainly because in my case, there's so much thematic overlap, I could see the potential for a conversation happening. I mean, I could see the links between the stories. And that's where, like, there's one part of me that gets really excited, and I'm like, oh boy, maybe this could make a collection. And then there's the other part of me that knows that when I start writing from this space of, like, I know this collection, I need a Chinatown story or something like that, I can feel my writing start to get really bad really quickly. Which is to say, like, it's very important for me to write from that place of urgency and that place of essentialness, to write because I feel like this is a story that I really need to tell. For me, I really need to tell it, not because I'm trying to fill a gap in a collection. Once I had finished the collection completely, at that point, I thought very explicitly about order, about construction, about architecture, about sort of revising the collection globally as a whole, but I really tried to not think too explicitly about it until I was in the later stage. So it was sort of almost like being willfully unconscious and then moving into this place of sort of hyper-consciousness later in the process.
Yeah, the exact same thing for me. I mean, I think that every time I've tried to write a story that I thought I should write, it's failed miserably. This is exactly what Laura was saying. And I just have sort of a very narrow patch of emotional terrain that I keep revisiting. And one of the reasons that the stories that I write are so sort of buried in setting is because in some ways I'm trying to mask that kind of emotional terrain, or I'm trying to get at it from a different angle. And so invariably those stories are going to end up feeling linked because they come from sort of that same bizarre sort of isolation. I won't get too far into it, but from that same emotional place. And so they kind of, in some ways, are echoes. And so it sort of happened naturally, but it wasn't on purpose. I wish that I could this sort of thing be like, this is the story that really ties the room together. But every time I've tried to do it, it just falls flat, and either I can't even finish it, or somebody will say, you know what, this story has no business being a story. It's, you can just tell that you're not feeling it. So.
Okay, well, I'm going to turn the floor over to our audience for a few questions, and then I'll wrap it all up with one question at the end. Does anyone have any questions for our writers? Okay.
This is for Ethan. I wanted to know how long your ship story was, because I've been told I'm trying to do too much in my stories, and it sounds like you have a lot going on there, but you pulled it together.
Yeah, well, some would say that, some would say
that. Oh, yeah.
No, you know, that is one of the hardest things to do in sort of in a short story is try to figure out what you're going to keep in and what you're not going to. You know, in a novel, you can really, you have a chance to have, as many kind of episodes as you want, as long as the emotional arc is sort of headed in the right direction.
Right.
In a short story, you really have to pick sort of that one kind of moment where things change, kind of that hinge moment. And particularly when you're writing historical fiction, that can be a real challenge because you go, and that's a cool part, and that's a cool part, and that's a cool part that you sort of need to get in there. And for me, it's just, it ends up sort of being in the drafting period. You get the story out, and then you go, you know, what is the most important and sort of tense moment here for my characters? And if that's, in that case, why am I waiting so long to get there? So it took me a long time to figure out that what I really needed to do with stories where it seemed like there was so much going on was to just start in the middle of the most tense part. And then I was shocked at how little of the rest of that stuff I had to actually include, if that makes sense. So my suggestion to that would simply be like, where is the story's heart beating? And don't worry about getting up to that point in your story. It's a short story. It has to be, by nature, it seems silly to say, but it has to be short. So you have to get to the action really quickly. And then the rest of your research will kind of inform all of that. It's very possible that you're working on a novel, though, without knowing it. You know, if you're trying to stuff too many clowns in the car, and you're not willing to kick a clown or two out of the car, you might have to go to a novel, you know? Which is good news, because novels sell.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Anyone have any questions? Anyone?
Would each of you tell me who you look to as a short story teller that you maybe read a lot of to get to be informed, or who are your favorite short story writers? Other than the three of you, I realize you each all would say each other, but not in the room.
Did you all hear that?
If you could repeat it, please.
So who do you look to as short story writers? Who do you admire? Who do you read? This is National Short Story Month, so some great suggestions would be wonderful.
Most important, you would not think of him as a short story writer, but necessarily, but one of the most important books for me as a short story writer has been Haruki Murakami's After the Quake. And I think we so often think of Murakami for these like big sprawling novels, and like I love the Windup or Chronicle, I love many of his novels, but I would with great passion and insistence, if given the opportunity, I would make the argument that After the Quake is his best book. It is just this absolutely exquisite story collection, and it's strange in the way that we anticipate Murakami will be strange, but I think it's also a really tight, really disciplined book with a phenomenal depth of feeling. That's one of my all-time favorite collections. Amy Hempel's collection, Reasons to Live, has been another touchstone for me. I love James Baldwin's short fiction I recently taught one of his stories, and just for, like, again, like, the sheer sort of depth of feeling, I think he sinks into the consciousness of his characters in a way that I think is just really rare to see on the page, sort of like a full commitment to a consciousness. I love Kelly Link. She's one of my all-time favorites. And I love, and I know Ethan will share this love, and I love Jim Shepherd, who's sort of the master at writing about anything, I think. So those are some of mine.
Thank you. I think for me, it's really important to me as a reader and as a writer to just read a wide variety of writing. Read work that's lyrical, that's, you know, language, really interested in how language can be manipulated. Read, you know, formalist stuff, people that are messing with different kinds of form. Look for different kinds of styles of writers. One anthology that I've really loved recently is called My Mother, She Killed Me, My Father, He Ate Me.
Yeah.
All contemporary fairy tales. So that was really awesome. You know, it's just inspiring to read work a lot of times that's different than yours, and then, you know, to kind of think about how you could incorporate some of the things that you admire into your own writing. So, but in terms of who has inspired, my style that I kind of see myself working in is in hyper-realism. So, you know, Laurie Moore, J.D. Salinger, Ernest Hemingway, even Raymond Carver, Deborah Eisenberg, Miranda July are some of the people that I've gone to that have kind of shaped me most stylistically. But I really love kind of stretching and just reading a wide variety of people, I guess. Yeah.
Those are great. I would echo all of those. I think Miranda July is terrific, and Laurie also took Haruki Murakami's After the Quake has been one of the most influential books on me as well. It's an amazing short story collection. And for the gentleman who's asking about sort of cramming stuff into short stories, there's two of my favorite writers do this incredibly well, and they're the people that I sort of am trying to kind of, you know, you go, oh, how do you do this kind of thing? Well, they do it perfectly. Mm-hmm. And it is Jim Shepherd, whose collection Love and Hydrogen, I think, is a great place to start. And Andrea Barrett, who writes about sort of science, and she gets so much into her short stories. You feel like you've read a novel, it's been 15 pages. And the book that I'd start with her is Ship Fever. But the person that I've been pressing onto people right now recently is Daphne du Maurier's collection of stories, Don't Look Now, which is, and I think this is, Jessica, you were talking about sort of like the weirdness and kind of the sense of dread. I think that's where that must come from for me. Is that particular story, Don't Look Now. It's just a masterpiece. And it's, maybe you have, people have seen the movie, but the short story itself is just incredible.
It's interesting that both of you mentioned After the Quake, because I just taught that in a linked story class that I was teaching. It's linked by this disaster, but it's none of this, it's, you know, the quake that happened in was it Kobe?
Yeah.
But none of the stories are about people who are directly affected by the tragedy. Yeah. It's all kind of indirect.
It's the aftermath.
Right, and people who weren't there, right? People who had relatives maybe kind of near there, or who just become obsessed with watching it on television. It was a really interesting book. It was quiet in compared to what my students were expecting.
Right.
Yeah. And it's
So now I'm going to wait and see if that book is on the shelf tomorrow. I'll be very disappointed in everyone.
There's a story, Super Frog Saves Tokyo, one of my favorite stories.
So
of all time.
Oh, it's so great. I teach that story like every semester. It's amazing.
Yeah.
I'm ducking under the desk for a second because I need to plug in my laptop.
Okay.
I will be right back.
Okay.
I was going to say too that the linked story form is kind of an interesting one to think about for this month. It's sort of in between recollection and novel. I'm also going to think about looking into some of those too.
And that could be another thing too, if you find yourself in that space, you can say, totally stealing that phrase, Ethan, and trying to like cram too many clowns into the clown car. I've heard of some people say what they've ended up doing in situations like that, where they did end up in story collection, they sort of broke up some of the stories. So maybe they pulled a character out of one story but gave them their own story, things like that. So that can be another way to approach that question of like proportion and how much can one story hold. I think, one thing that I was thinking about hearing you guys talk to that question of how much can a story hold, and I think both Jim Shepherd and Andrea Baird are so sort of novelistic in their approach to story writing, and also Alice Munro, of course, the great Alice Munro, and she does like the most amazing things with time.
Oh my God.
And I think that time in fiction is always a really important question, but that economy of time is so important in the short form, where it's like Alice Munro will have 10 years pass in a sentence, but one moment will span that hinge moment, as Ethan said. One moment might span 5 pages, but then years might pass in a single sentence.
And what's amazing with Alice Munro too is if you read one paragraph, and there'll be 7 or 8 time switches in one paragraph. It's pretty amazing.
Yeah, so that ability to sort of compress time when you need to compress it, and then make it sort of elastic and extend it too is.
Any other questions for our writers?
Do all three of you have any thoughts on the passing of Gabriel Garcia Marquez? Was he any influence on you at all? Did he have an effect on you?
Did you hear that?
I feel greatly saddened by it. I think Love in the Time of the Cholera is an amazing, amazing book. And so is Chronicle of a Death Foretold. But I can't say that stylistically, I feel like I've sort of followed him in terms of, some of the magical realism. But I think that I think that his books are really amazing.
Yeah, I would echo that. Like, I love him as a reader. I often teach his stories, and it's just, I'm saddened to think that he's not in the world anymore.
Yeah, same.
He's somewhere. He's going, oh, that had such a big impact on you guys.
I feel like he's not overly concerned.
One more?
Ethan, I would like to hear more about the violence that you brought up, about before and after becoming a parent. Sort of, if you can talk a little bit about where that came from initially, what was interesting to you about violence?
Yeah, well, I was writing about this, and I was trying to figure it out myself. Why is it, am I just depraved? Like, what is it that sort of that interests me about violence? And one of the things is that one of the ways that I sort of get into stories is that I scare myself, and I start to think, the question that I ask myself is, what's the worst thing that could happen? And so that's how a lot of my stories start. It's a father, one of the stories in the book is a father and a son alone on a boat, and they're having a great vacation, but they're very isolated. They're on the west coast of Vancouver Island. And I was like, this isn't a story. I just don't have a story yet. And I was like, what's the worst thing that could happen? Like, well, the worst thing that could happen is a character, like a misfit character, a psychopath, could sort of walk out of the woods. And then what's going to happen? And then suddenly the story took shape for me, and it was all from the question of what's the worst thing that could happen. Now that I'm a parent, you know, what's the worst thing that could happen? When I even think about that question, I can only think of one thing, which is losing my kids. And it's not something, it's so overwhelming to me that I don't find it, it's not fictively productive for me, it's just too overwhelming. So that's the ways in which, like, that question for me has had to be adjusted. And I think that that's just sort of part of getting older as well. I mean, I think that was sort of a myopic way of looking at stories, where not every story needs to have a question asked of it, you know, what's the worst thing that could happen? That's the thing that should happen in the story, or it's not a story. I'm getting more interested in sort of the smaller shifts, smaller disappointments. What Jessica and Laura do so well, the idea of doubt. I mean, doubt is now something that it's just overwhelms me in my life right now. And it's becoming much more interesting to me as a fictive, sort of as like an emotional engine to push a story from point A to point B. So rather than the external events affecting a story, I'm becoming more interested in sort of the interior life of my characters, which probably should have happened when I started, but that's just not what happened.
And it's sort of interesting too, Ethan, because I think, and I don't know if you guys would agree, but I feel like in life, sort of when I think about the big choices I've made, some of them that have worked out well and some of them that have been totally like misguided and ill-informed, I think doubt for me has often been a much more powerful driving force to choose one thing or another, you know, to pull back from one thing and to move towards something else, as opposed to like the big sweeping emotions that we might think of as being great dramatic material, like, you know, like passion, like rage, like, you know, like revenge, things like that. It has been those sort of more nuanced emotions, those sort of more slippery, ambiguous emotions. And I think that is, you know, because it's, I think so often that those can be powerful driving forces in life, that they too can just be powerful driving forces for characters.
And I feel like violence is part of our psyche. Like, it's part of our culture, it's part of our internal urges, secret id kind of stuff, that I know writing for me accesses parts of me that I'm not fully conscious of or aware of or something. So, you know, I don't maybe have a lot of direct, like, physical violence in my pieces, but I definitely find myself using violent imagery in places, or, I don't know, having characters maybe think, sort of have violent impulses or something. And I think that's important to explore. And that's probably where a lot of those, because a lot of your pieces, I feel like, start off sometimes in a somewhat quiet space, or they'll start off with a violent act and then kind of return to a domestic space that then the violence kind of, starts to infiltrate or something. So I don't know, there's a tension there, I think, between violence and quiet, domestic, and I don't know, even with the story you mentioned with the guy who walks out of the woods, you know, it's the father and son kind of dynamic that we start with, where there's a sort of strange tension in and of itself, and yeah.
I've wondered with that story, though, if it would have been, and this is something I really would have loved to as a kid, is it, could that story have succeeded without somebody coming out of the woods? And I'd like to think that I would be able to write that story with the tension that you're talking about and sort of the doubt, and I feel like that's an area that I'm interested in exploring more, and sort of having my sort of default be, you know, let's bring in the monster.
Okay, we've got one more question here.
How much sounding of others do you get for a story before you say it's a go? And do you trust it always?
This has changed for me. I used to show my stories to a lot of people. I was in a program, and that started to sort of be sensory overload, and so I stopped showing. The only person actually that I show my stories to is Laura's husband. he's the only guy that I send my stories to ahead of time, just because we've been sending stories to each other for like 15 years now. And I just I trust him. Stylistically, we're so different that there's no sense of bleeding into each other stylistically. He just tells me what works and what doesn't. But so he's the only one, for better or for worse.
And I'm always trying to, like, I'm like, can I, like, steal Ethan's new story and read it just for my own pleasure? And he guards them very, very closely. You're in good hands. I would say it's sort of similar for me. I mean, like, Ethan, I always think it's like we were in a program that it sounds like we were all in Alcoholics Anonymous or something. Like, we were in the program. I, too, was in a program. And so I spent a lot of years in workshop.
Oh,
Laura, your audio vanished.
No.
Can you mime it?
She's gone.
Coming back.
Hi. Did I come back?
Yes.
Audio-wise, yes, you're here.
Yes.
Okay. Can you hear me?
We can hear you.
Okay, great. So like Ethan, I too was in a workshop, and so I was constantly showing new work to my workshop community. And then one of the most meaningful things that I got in my MFA program was a really, you know, they were like two or three people that I really bonded closely with in my program, and afterwards we remained readers of each other's work. And I shared, as I said, my husband, who Ethan is sharing his stories with, my husband's definitely an early reader for me as well. But I find that I am waiting till later in the process to share stories. I think even if you had asked me this question 5 or so years ago, I think I tended to share early drafts more. And I think I'm more and more moving into a space where I really want to take something as far as I can before I share it with other people. And I think you always have to filter. Like, you always have to think, you know, to be hard on yourself and to be rigorous with yourself and to ask yourself, am I rejecting a piece of advice simply because it seems like too much work or it seems like it's challenging my vision of the story in a way that maybe is uncomfortable for me. But at the same time, I think it's a balance where you need to be open, you need to be sort of porous, but you also have to filter. And I think for me that process gets easier if I show work that's in the later stages, because at that point, like, I have for better or for worse, I have a vision of what that I want that story to be, and I can look at the feedback sort of through that lens.
Yeah, I think maybe I do show drafts a little earlier still than I would necessarily need to people that I trust. And part of what I feel for me is important in having readers is having people who are able to tell me, you know, it seems like these are some things that you're interested in. Here's what I feel like the story's up to. Here's what it's doing stylistically, or the images, you know, things that I'm kind of subconsciously putting in, but haven't figured out what they're doing in there yet or where I could take it. And then having a conversation that's more about what are the possibilities for where this could go with what you're already kind of seeming to be working with. And that's really useful for me to do early on, and then to kind of sit with the comments for a while and, you know, go back into it, and then sit on the story for, you know, another month or two, don't look at it, and then go back, you know, always kind of having another project to then work on while I sit on an old one and come back to it again. But for me, I feel more comfortable, I guess, showing pieces that are earlier in the process when I'm less kind of committed to a particular vision. And then I have a harder time, I think, maybe showing the later draft ones.
Great. Well, I want to thank Ethan, Jessica, and Laura for spending some time with us tonight. The experiment worked. That was good. All of their books we have at the library, so feel free, if you haven't already read any of them, to check them out and check out most of the books they mentioned we also have at the library here, so check those out as well. So anyway, thanks again, and... Have a nice night, everyone.
I don't want to speak for everybody else, but if you had a question for me or for, well, I'll also answer on for them, but you should feel free to email me a question if you feel like it. I have nothing but time. I have a brand new baby. I don't sleep.
Nothing but time.
If there's something you didn't get to, I'd be happy to, go back and forth over to email.
Yeah, I have noticed, Ethan, that I put anything on Facebook and you like it like that. You're always on there right now. So.
Just your stuff.
Just for me. It's great.
Ben, what's his email?
Oh, do you want to share your email, Ethan?
No.
Oh, yeah. It's just my name, just EthanRutherford@hotmail.com. You can find it on, it's maybe idiotically, it's on the website. You can just find, you just go to EthanRutherford.com and that's my, or .net, and it's just EthanRutherford@hotmail is my email address.
Thank you.
Same, if anybody has questions for me, feel free to email.
Yeah, I would offer the same as well, and my email is also on my website.
Yes, and all of their websites are linked right on our website. If you go into the author's live section, click on their names, they'll bring you right to their website. So all of their information is right there as well.
Wow.
Okay, guys, I'll send you an email.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much.
Talk soon.